Minecraft is a creative survival game where you must mine for resources, build tools, farms, explore the world in search of valuable treasures, and build portals to neighboring worlds, the Nether and the End. It's a social game as well, where friends from different platforms can join in to work together to build interesting structures, and an intuitive interface to program your own servers and mods. Recently, Minecraft for Windows 10 had an update to its renderer that introduced dramatic improvements to its design, adding real-time ray tracing denoising, and deep learning supersampling. So let's review how Minecraft RTX renders a single frame, referencing research papers where appropriate. Note, this is not an official analysis of the Minecraft RTX renderer. This is a beta version of the renderer, so the design presented here may change in the final release. Prior to rendering, some pre-processing is done to cache physically based rendering, PBR, material textures to a 2048x2048 lookup texture, LUT. Each frame of Minecraft RTX begins by building bottom level acceleration data structures for any animated objects in the scene, such as animals or players. Our top level acceleration structure for the scene is built, and we proceed to dispatch rays for our primary rays and sunlight shadows, writing to a variety of different outputs, such as normals, albedo and metalness, emissive and roughness, opacity and material ID, velocity, cached irradiance, reprojected primary path length, low precision position, geometric normals, volumetric light ray shadows, view position, view direction, and throughput. All passes are rendered twice next to one another on the x-axis at 742x835 for a total of 1484x835 instead of 2560x1440. This odd number appears to just be a quarter on x and half on y of the output resolution plus some padding. On the left is primary ray hit data, and on the right is primary ray hit data through transmissive surfaces such as water. For sampling, Minecraft uses a blue noise array of 128x256x256 images. More rays are cast for non-primary rays, writing to indirect diffuse, indirect diffuse chroma, then more rays are dispatched, writing to indirect specular and reflection distance. Volumetric fog is computed last to a downscaled 3D texture. Minecraft uses adaptive spatial-temporal filtering, which consists of a variance-driven adaptive spatial-temporal reprojection step, which takes our moment buffers, history length, and previous frames, and tries to put that data where it would be in the current frame. This is followed by a bilinear filtering step, where over the course of several passes, they adaptively blur these frames. They also use a form of irradiance caching to help with resolving reprojected regions with little history information quicker. Finally, interleaved buffers are combined to produce the final output that will be fed to the Deep Learning Supersampling DLSS 2.0 kernel. Deep Learning Supersampling 2.0 uses an autoencoder that takes as input a jittered render target at a fraction of our output resolution, a jittered velocity buffer similar to temporal anti-aliasing, and outputs an upscaled version of the final output. UIs are rendered out at full resolution to a separate render target and composited at the end of the frame. Minecraft finishes the frame with tone mapping and any enabled post-processing effects such as vignette. Minecraft is a game that really benefits from a ray tracing system. With its dynamic environments and extreme variance in shadows and lighting, traversing cave systems and exploring structures feels much more immersive and interesting. If this was insightful, or if you have any suggestions for another game to analyze, let me know in the comments, and I'll see you next time.